Hello and welcome to the Power BI July 2021 update. In this video, we'll explore what's new this month and see some demos of the highlights. We have some exciting new features for you in the reporting section. First, we're excited to announce that small multiples is now generally available. Thank you for all of your feedback throughout the preview period, and please continue to send us feedback about how this feature can be improved. We've included two improvements to the feature this month. First, we've improved keyboard navigation and screen reader support for small multiples. Moving focus around the small multiples grid should now be more consistent and intuitive, and screen reader readouts should be descriptive. Second, we've introduced sorting functionality for your small multiples, allowing you to sort the order in which they appear by the measures in your field wells. This is useful for cases like seeing the highest cumulative value, small multiples first, and will help you make more useful comparisons. We've also added conditional formatting to various properties across our visuals. Now, in addition to all of the properties which already supported conditional formatting, you'll find entry points for color and text formatting in new areas as well. Check out this month's blog post to learn more. Next, Power BI's built-in visuals now include the Power Automate visual. The Power Automate visual allows users to go from insights to action without leaving the context of the report. Back in April, we released a preview of this visual to AppSource, and this month, you'll now find the visual in the Visualizations pane by default. Next, sensitivity labels in Power BI Desktop are now generally available. With Microsoft Information Protection sensitivity labels, creators can easily label and protect sensitive content all within the desktop app. With this release, creators will be able to republish PBIX files without overriding sensitivity labels on destination datasets or reports. This is useful for cases where the sensitivity label applied on the PBIX file doesn't match the sensitivity of the data of the target in the service, whether it's because the data sources are different or because the report in the service is applied with different sensitivity labels than the one in the dataset. Starting this month, Power BI reports will also now inherit sensitivity labels set to Excel files when getting data from them. Excel files are some of the most popular data sources for Power BI reports. So when you get data from protected Excel files, the downstream Power BI dataset and report will inherit those labels as well. In the analytics section, we're happy to announce that we now support sharing synonyms for everyone in your organization. Field synonyms are an important part of Q&A because users often have a variety of terms they use to refer to the same field. For example, total sales, net sales, total net sales. Now you can leverage your coworkers' synonyms and minimize duplicate efforts when adding synonyms to your models. We have some exciting new updates for you in the modeling section. First, the new model UI is now generally available. Thank you to everyone who provided feedback and your continued support. To see all of the new features that were added, you can visit one of our previous blog posts. And please keep in mind that if you are using a report that you haven't already upgraded to the new model view, it will automatically be upgraded for you now. Next, we're continuing our work on DirectQuery for Azure Analysis Services and Power BI datasets by improving support for the flow of properties to your local model. If the remote model you've connected to has date tables or auto-generated date tables, those will now show up in your local model. Further, if your remote model has lineage tags defined, any renames on the remote model will show up in your local model without the renamed objects being deleted or recreated. This also means you won't lose any local customizations on objects that have been renamed. In the data connectivity section, we're excited to announce the release of the Amazon Athena connector. Athena is an interactive query service that makes it easy to analyze data stored in Amazon S3 and other relational, non-relational, and custom data sources through federated queries. Using the Amazon Athena connector for Power BI, you can now query, analyze, visualize, and share insights from your data lake with teammates across your organization. We've also updated the Databricks, Dremio, and MariaDB connectors. We have a variety of updates for you in the service section. First, streaming data flows is now in preview. Streaming data flows allows every business analyst to work with streaming data with beautiful drag and drop, no code experiences. Users can now connect to, prepare, and visualize real-time data to create end-to-end streaming analytics solutions directly in Power BI. Miguel will show us a demo of this exciting new feature.
Okay, let's take a look at streaming data flows. As you can see here, I'm on my premium workspace in Power BI. And if I click on new, I'm going to have a new option called streaming data flow. I'm going to click on it and we're going to give it a name. In this case, we're looking at toll data, so we'll call it toll. And then once we land in the authoring experience, there's going to be three key parts here. Number one is the ribbon where you have all of your inputs, transformations, output, and of course the save button. Number two is the data preview tab where you can also access authoring errors and runtime errors in a table. And number three is the blank canvas where you can create your streaming data flow and the logic. So let's start adding an input, event hub, which is one of the ones that we support. We'll paste the connection string and click connect. You're going to have two options here. You can add fields manually or we can auto-detect like I'm doing here. And you get the live preview right away. You can actually see the data coming in as you connect to that source. The other thing that we can do here is we can remove, rename, or change the data types of the inputs. In this particular case, we have the entry time, so let's switch that to date time to make sure that we can use it after. And we also support nested objects, as you can see here. Okay, let me show you now the authoring errors table, where let me add another card so we can see more errors. When you click on any of the warnings or the errors, you will pre-select the card so you can fix it. Now, let's add some transformations so we can see what we can do. Let's start with manage fields, which is the most straightforward one where you can select, for example, the objects in that nested object field, like the car model, or you can rename. Basically, you can do whatever you want with those fields. So let's start adding the ones that are under that car model. Let's go with make. Let's go with model itself. We also have vehicle type, so we'll add that too. That way we are parsing that nested object so we have it available in the table when we want to do some analysis. And last but not least, vehicle weight, and then I can rename, let's say, weight. So now that I'm happy with this, basically we can proceed and add, for example, an output right away, which is a table that will go directly into Power BI. So let's connect the notes. And let's make sure that we give a name, all data, because it's all the data that we have. And as you can see here, each card will give you a glimpse of the logic that you have, depending, of course, on what that transformation is. And I can also zoom in and zoom out. Let's actually take a look at the preview that you can get once you have some logic in here. You can click on Get Static Preview, and streaming data flows will basically run a simulation or a sampling of that data so you can see it. And of course, you always have the live preview where you can see the actual record, or you can pause it in case you want to see something specific. Let's keep going now. Why don't we add another transformation? Let's do a group by. This is a very interesting one because this is where streaming becomes unique with the time dimension. We can select the aggregation. We have a bunch available here. Why don't we do something like count and let's do license plate. So something very straightforward, counting the cars going through the toll. And then we will have the time window here where we have several options. We'll do tumbling and we'll count every 5 seconds the cars that are coming in. Same as before, we'll put the output table here. We'll name it count 5 seconds. And then, as you can see, we can add multiple outputs to the streaming data flow. Let's do one last one, also very straightforward. It's going to be a filter, and maybe we'll do make, and we'll filter all the cards that are make for it. Also, we can do any of those other options in a filter, very straightforward. And we'll add the last output table that we have here. We'll call it Ford cars. Now let's run a preview again, just to make sure that everything is working. When you run the preview once, it runs the whole tree. So you will get a preview of everything that we have here. In this case, we're doing the group by every 5 seconds. Looks like we are happy with everything we have. Remember, we can reshape it. We'll save. And now is the moment to run that streaming data flow. If you hover over the data flow, you will see that play icon. That's how you start it. It's a continuous run. I have one running here, which is the one that we'll use from desktop. Same thing. If you hover, you can actually stop it. So let's start it. It will start. And now let's go to desktop. Here is where things work exactly the same. So we'll go to get data. And the connector that we're going to use is one that has been released this month too, which is the Power Platform Dataflows beta connector. The Power BI Dataflows would also work, but it will have some caveats that we listed in our documentation. So I'm going to search for the streaming Dataflows workspace. We're going to expand it. You can see both Dataflows there. And here's the interesting part. You will see two sets of tables. One, it's streaming data or hot. That is for the real-time visualization. The other one is archive data cold. So imagine this has been running for a month, let's say. If you want historical data, you go to the latter. If you want real-time, like we're going to do right now, you connect to the streaming one. It's important to make sure that you select DirectQuery once you're choosing the storage mode, just because if you want visuals that will update in real-time, it needs to be DirectQuery. So now let's expand the all data table that we have. And let's actually take advantage of the relative time filter here in the filter pane. So we'll do the last 5 minutes just to make sure that we actually see the data moving once we create the visuals. Let's do a line chart first, something very straightforward, of course, over time, and maybe we'll do revenue, which is the money that we're getting for each car passing the toll. And maybe let's do something else. Let's count the cars, and we'll do that the same way we did before with the license plate, and we'll switch to count. Now, this is the time where we'll make the visuals move. We'll go to the format pane for the page, and we can see here that we have automatic page refresh. We'll expand it, turn it on, and select up to 1 second refreshes. You will see the data starts moving right away thanks to this particular feature. So the data is coming through the streaming data flow, landing in Power BI, and then using automatic page refresh, we can see the real time moving here. We switch it to 3 minutes so we can see it a little bit better. Thank you so much.
Many organizations require users to classify their sensitive information to meet regulatory, compliance, or internal audit requirements. Now, with a mandatory label policy, you can require creators to set a sensitivity label when they create new content or edit existing content in Power BI. Creators will be required to apply the sensitivity label when they upload a PBIX file to Power BI or when they create new content or edit content without a label in Power BI. You can also set a sensitivity label on paginated reports in the Power BI service the same way you can set labels on Power BI reports. The label and protection will be set to files created when exporting data from paginated reports to Word, Excel, PowerPoint, and PDF files. Additionally, to help your organization's Power BI users understand what your sensitivity labels mean or how they should be used, you can provide a Learn More link pointing to your organization's custom web page that users will see when they're applying or being prompted to apply sensitivity labels. Next, we've made a number of improvements to the Datasets Hub, including new sharing capabilities, chat in Teams, dataset share, refresh and schedule refresh, dataset descriptions, and goals. You can find these new features in the Dataset Hub landing page and the dataset page. Last December, we announced new scanner APIs for extracting tenant-level metadata using admin REST APIs. We already see many customers using the new APIs to query Power BI to build their own reporting and homegrown catalogs. And our latest improvements include items you have been asking for the most. We've now enhanced the APIs to include dataset labels, columns, measures, DAX expressions, and mashup queries. In the visualization section, we have several exciting new and updated visuals available for you on AppSource. New this month are the multi-info cards by Portfolio Consultoria Empresarial and the Pure Viz infographic by Pure Viz. Visuals that have been updated this month are the Multiple Sparklines visual by excelandaccess.com, the Actaris Reporting visual by Actaris, the Dynamic Radial Bar Chart by JTA, the drill down waterfall pro visual by zoom charts, the charticulator visual, and the control chart XMR by Nova Silva BV. This month's editor's picks are the go-to stratum visual by Sylvan Software Inc., the packed bubble chart by XViz, the multiple sparklines visual by excelandaccess.com, the bowtie chart by Mac Software, and the ultimate variance chart by DataViz Boutique GmbH. You can find these editor's picks and all of the other mentioned visuals on AppSource. And that's all for this month. As always, we hope you enjoy the updates and please keep sending us feedback on what you'd like to see in upcoming releases. Thanks for watching and we'll see you again next month.